Hey everybody, you're listening to the Cheap Geek Podcast. And it begins again. Hello, and welcome to CheapGeek Podcast. This is episode number 29. That's you.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
This episode is Truth, Speculation, and Reputation.
All right, so we're back again, and here it is one more time where we talk about things that are interesting to us and hopefully interesting to you, and if they're not, just pretend and play along. So, it begins, right? So,
yes.
Let's just do this. We put a phone number up there for you guys to call, so you can call the show and leave us a message, a voicemail message, a message, if you will, so we can find out what you're thinking about, what you're talking about, what you want to know about the show.
And that phone number is 1-575-208-4025.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's a Roswell area code because that's what makes it cool. You know, it's all like aliens and stuff. So,
yeah.
Okay. So this episode is Truth, Speculation, and Reputation. And we should go ahead and say right out of the gate, we have a whole bunch of stuff, a potpourri of things to speak about.
Okay.
And they are all unrelated, but they're all related. And it's up to you to figure out how they relate.
All right.
So, okay. You know, before we talked about some of these dietary supplements and they weren't working, namely the old fish oil.
Yeah.
Well, this is a list of some supplements that may actually sort of do something.
Well, that's kind of good. I mean.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, we spend a lot of money, right?
Yeah. In fact, I think we're running low on a couple of supplements we take.
We are indeed.
Yeah.
But, you know, we're not alone because about half of Americans take a vitamin or a vitamin or mineral supplement daily.
Yes.
And
which kind of stinks because if you think about it, the reason we're taking vitamins and minerals is because we're not getting it from our food and from our diet.
And we're all lazy.
That's true.
You know, it's like going back to when you see like this 80-year-old, 90-year-old farmer, right? And like, well, how do you live so long? Well, I drink whiskey every day and I eat meat and I do all this stuff. And you're like, what? How is that possible? Because they're active all day long. These people work and they burn off whatever they put in them.
Yeah.
We don't do that anymore, most of us.
Nope.
And most of us get our coffee and get in the car and go.
And the fact that we live such a sedentary lifestyle means that we actually require more minerals.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
That's true. So, according to data from the National Health and Nutritional Examination Survey, right?
Yeah.
They're going to talk about some vitamins and minerals in this list of things that may actually work. So, here's a list of supplements that repeated scientific studies have proven to do something.
Yes.
They put a little disclaimer here, too. They're like, do not take this as medical advice. If you are worried, please talk to your doctor or dietitian. Who will hopefully recommend you change your diet before taking a supplement.
Okay.
So, here we go. This one actually does work, or at least it feels like it works to me, and this is called vitamin D.
Yes, and so, what it does is it helps promote bone growth.
Yes.
And you should also take it if you have a vitamin D deficiency, or occasionally it helps with sleep.
And rickets.
Oh, yeah.
And bone disease. So, if you need some D, get the old vitamin D, right? If you're lacking it. So possibly 10% or basically, okay, I don't want to read all that stuff, but what it boils down to, it's the deficiency that can increase the risk of common illnesses.
Mm-hmm.
So vitamin D will help with, like I was saying, rickets, bone disease, and if things get bad, then, you know, I don't know.
And here's the thing, vitamin D.
It also helps with sleep and melatonin.
Yeah. Vitamin D helps for, it helps the production of, what is it, like melanin or something?
Melanin or melatonin?
Yeah.
That kind of thing.
And we used to get this from, you know, limited sun exposure and some sun exposure. But as we've become more industrialized and more people work indoors, we don't get it. In fact, there are statistics saying at least 30% of people who work in things like call centers or work the night shift have a vitamin D deficiency.
Yes. So, less than half of Americans get more than 30 nanograms of vitamin D per milliliter of blood, according to the Scientific American article.
Yeah.
So, and basically the amount the doctor thinks is healthy, but around twice the amount used to diagnose a true vitamin D deficiency, right? So what they're saying is that you need between 400 and 800 units of vitamin D.
Yeah.
It's international units. You ever seen IU?
Yeah.
On a pill bottle, like for supplements? That means international unit.
Yeah.
So pretty much what they're saying is that we need more. Now, there is some vitamin D in milk, but it's just not enough.
Hmm.
So, yeah, get you some vitamin D. Okay. Actually, it seems like whenever we take it, it helps me sleep.
Yes. It does make you sleepy.
Yeah. Well, it makes me sleep.
Yeah.
More better. More better. Calcium is the next on the list. What it do? Promotes bone growth, right?
Yep.
Helps reduce premature births.
Births.
I cannot talk today. I need a supplement to help me speak.
And the people who should take it, now this actually is...
Adolescent boys and girls?
Pregnant people or teenagers if they aren't getting enough in their diet. Also, the recent study, and this is outside of this article, states that women over 30 should actually start taking it in limited amounts because all of us over 30, we're drinking sodas. And soda actually strips the calcium from your body.
From your bones, man.
Mm-hmm.
And you know who else should take it?
Who?
Vegans.
Yeah, that's
lactose
true.
Lactose intolerant people.
Yeah.
Since, you know, they don't want to get the old calcium from the milks because they're avoiding dairy. So, yeah, well, okay, vitamin D I knew kind of worked, you know, calcium, it kind of makes sense, kind of worked because that's something that's been out there for a while. The next one is iron.
Yeah.
And I misread this. It says, helps reduce anemia in menstruating people. Now, last time I checked...
Only the ladies do that.
I thought that only the ladies did that.
Yes.
But when I read it really quick, I thought it said helps reduce anemia in frustrating people. And I was thinking, there's a whole buttload of people I know that could use some iron.
You're terrible.
So, now, it kind of goes hand in hand now that I have reread this correctly, where it helps reduce anemia in menstruating people. So, it could say in frustrating menstruating people.
Hey.
Yeah.
You know what?
So, if you're a person who loses blood, like you're pregnant or menstruating, you should probably take some irons.
Or if you donate blood on a regular basis.
Yeah.
Yep.
So. Because iron is basically an important function when it comes to the old hemoglobin, the protein in the blood cells that helps carry oxygen all over your body.
Mm-hmm.
And so, meat and vegetables generally contain enough iron for your diet. But, you know, iron in meat presents the molecules called heme, while the iron in vegetables is usually on its own. So
you know what actually,
we need a little heme.
Yeah, you know what actually has a lot of iron in it and almost more than greens?
Steak.
Besides steak, actually it has more than steak.
What?
Microwavable cream of wheat. I got diagnosed with anemia when I was 17.
That's frustrating.
Yeah, and my diet for a couple of months there was 2 packets of cream of wheat, steak, and greens.
Sounds tasty.
Yeah, but it turned out the cream of wheat had more vitamin or had more iron and like 2 other more minerals than like eating greens.
Hmm.
Yeah, but it was only the microwavable one.
That's weird.
Yeah, so. But the next one I've actually been curious about because everybody heard about this in the late 90s, early 2000s, but I never looked into it before. Creatine. And supposedly what it does is boost muscle performance. Who should take it? Athletes or those with muscular dystrophy?
Or vegans.
Really?
I don't know.
Oh. Supposedly, creatine, the way it works is it creates, I don't know, better performance and has been linked to enhancing muscle mass. But it can also cause muscles to retain water and make athletes feel heavy. Which I kind of think would be bad, especially like if you're a swimmer or something. You can get it from drinking a protein shake. There's lots of sources out there for where you can get it. People with muscular dystrophy can benefit. This is a disease where muscles get weaker over time. But after taking creatine for, you know, a trial period, a lot of them actually feel better.
That's cool.
Mm-hmm. And then this one. The next one is melatonin.
Melatonin.
Yes. And this helps regulate the body's daily cycle. Who should take it? Shift workers or folks suffering from jet lag? Which is funny because I thought melatonin was supposed to help you sleep.
Well, it does. But,
I
don't know. It's kind of weird because I've taken this stuff before in the past and I stopped taking it.
Yeah.
Because, like, one of the things they say here is, taken right before bed, melatonin has probably delivered you a batch of wild dreams and make you feel groggy the next day.
Exactly.
And I was like, yeah, and that was exactly what I experienced, these crazy dreams and just being out of it, right?
Yeah.
Kind of reminds me of Ambien. Sort of crazy, but anyway.
Yeah.
You know, it does play a role in sleep.
Mm-hmm.
And what they're saying is melatonin is remarkably effective at preventing jet lag. And it should be recommended to adult travelers flying across four or five more time zones, particularly in an easterly direction, and especially if they have experienced jet lag on previous journeys. But if you take it in the morning, right, it can cause grogginess during the day. But basically, they're saying take it if you want to sleep, because that's what helps the shift workers who work during the evening and sleep during the day.
Yeah.
That's what helps them sleep. And it slightly improves their sleep length and quality. And see, when I worked sort of a swing shift where it was, not really a swing shift, but like a mid shift kind of thing, where it was like 3:30 to midnight. I didn't go to bed till like 3 o'clock in the morning. I worked that way for like 8 years, but
yep.
I took the melatonin for a while to try to help me sleep during the day, and it worked. But what I found was is that it just wasn't worth. It was just weird. It seemed like it took me longer to get going, and the dreams were kind of cool, but they were also kind of weird. So I was like, you know.
And see, for me, it didn't actually help me fall asleep. But when I finally did fall asleep, terrible, terrible nightmares. Yeah. I'm talking like end of the world, zombies eating me, freaking terrible nightmares.
Yeah. So melatonin is kind of weird.
Yeah. It didn't work for me. I found vitamin D worked better. But I do understand that, you know, it's like one of the top suggestions if you have a hard time sleeping because you're a shift worker.
Yeah.
So just, you know.
Well, I think if you take melatonin and vitamin D together, you maybe will sleep harder and longer.
Maybe.
But you'll probably have some super crazy dreams.
Well, the cool thing about almost all these supplements in this article, except for the creatine one, melatonin, vitamin D, calcium, these are all inexpensive supplements.
Yep.
And you can always buy the melatonin or the vitamin D in a smaller little bottle. I think I can get vitamin D from my local like Walgreens for like $3. Yeah, and if you go to Walmart, it's even cheaper, especially the melatonin. I know they have it cheap there. So
that's just pretty cool.
You know, it's something worth trying.
Very nice.
Yep.
So we thought that was pretty interesting, actually. And, you know, yeah.
Okay.
That's about all I got to say about that. But, you know, here's something that may be interesting to those people out there who listen to the podcast who may or may not know cameras and videos and digital type stuff. Right?
Okay.
I found this article because I do digital photography quite a bit, and I like it. And it's just kind of one of my things to do. But what I found was, is this little article. It says, 5 essentials for making your homemade videos look better. I have a YouTube channel, been doing it for a little while. And so I do periodically take a look to see exactly what I'm not doing. And then later on continue to not do what the article suggests. So I was like, well, let me see what they got here, right? I don't consider myself to be an expert, but I am. But that's a different story altogether. But there were some really good things in here, and not only does this help for home videos, but this also can really help sort of step up your photography game in general. So I figured I'd put this article in here so that you could listen and read it and look at it, and we have links, and these links are in our show notes, and our show notes are on every outlet you see, I shouldn't say see, or every outlet you can get the Cheap Geek podcast. So
okay.
If you go to the website, if you go to our Libsyn page, if you go to any one of the other websites we have, or even if you're watching or listening on YouTube, there'll be the links in there. So it was some pretty sound advice, and I would like to go ahead and tell you the first one.
Okay.
The first one is make lighting your top priority.
Yeah.
This is absolutely the, I think, and this is the reason why it's number one. The number one thing when it comes to video and photography, light is king, period.
Yeah.
Right? Now, you know, when it comes to video, typically there's a couple different ways you can light the scene, if you will. And the scene is basically whatever you're filming to turn it into your video. But it doesn't matter whether you're doing a three-point lighting setup or just using the sun. Lighting is the most important thing.
Yes.
And if you can't get some good lights, you know, use a window.
Yeah.
You know, something like that. But there's lots of different ways to light your scene. I mean, you can take lamps from anywhere. You can put different light bulbs in there. You know, and light bulbs, like they used to have these GE Reveal series light bulbs that had the nice sort of warmish, correct sun-tone daylight or sunlight-daylight balanced Kelvin scale.
Yep.
And if you couldn't find those, you could find the ones that were around 5,000 Kelvin. Those were perfect. Those worked great. You can get like 4 or 5 of those, put them in some lamps. But either way, light your scene. Light is king.
Mm-hmm.
And if you think there's plenty enough light, chances are there's not. Yeah. Because the camera can't see as well as your eyes.
That's very true.
Yeah. So the second one is, and I kind of agree with this, but I kind of don't, edit to the music.
Yep.
And sound can dramatically change the way shots are perceived, and cheesy music will make for a cheesy video or ruin a shot that you want to see as being intense. So music immediately sets the tone and can be used to emphasize big moments and cuts. So keep that in mind as you edit your video.
Yeah.
Okay, so you need to have good light. You need to add some music. I like how they say cheesy. Cheesy music, which is what I like, can make your video cheesy. So if that's not what you're going for, pick something appropriate.
And then the other three suggestions I don't really agree with. I kind of think they're a little too high and mighty almost. I mean, the third one does make a little bit of sense. Actually learn your software. Yes, but here's the thing. Even amateurs and people first getting into videography as well as photography, your computer, whether it's a Mac or a PC, comes with basic software. Learn that basic software and get comfortable with it. And then, if you're really doing full-blown editing, invest in software that you plan to learn and keep.
So, yeah, there's actually software I use.
Yeah.
And I recently bought another version of that software because I update it periodically. And there's also a free version of software, which I should probably talk about a little bit, but it might be, I don't know if it'd be above what the average person would use, but I'm kind of having a moral dilemma here.
Okay.
Because it's free software, but it is slightly complicated, and there is a learning curve involved. But I think once you get it to where you can use it and effectively utilize some of its abilities, it's an amazing software, and it's absolutely free. And I'll tell you about it anyway. It's called Hitman Express. Actually, hold on. It's not Hitman Express. Isn't that a wrestler?
I don't know.
Oh, hold on. Let me look real quick. This is actually something I ran across. I think it's Hitman 4. Let me look here. I can't remember.
Okay.
Look, I'll come back to it. And we may actually talk about it. It's a free software that is very powerful software for not costing anything. But I don't want to waste too much time on that because it is something that goes a little bit beyond what this article talks about and kind of where I think it needs to be. But actually learning your software is something that's useful because it does make your task easier. But this one I can kind of agree with, and this is something that I'm guilty of not doing.
What?
Just basically adding just a little bit of motion to your shots. Right? I mean, because what they're trying to say in this little thing right here is it says don't just shoot everything from a tripod. Yeah. It's static and boring, but it doesn't have to be crazy either. So it just says, like, slowly approach the subject, pan to the left, pan to the right, rotate around the subject. If the camera is moving, it helps to advance the story along. And I understand what you're saying. Not every shot has to be a static shot, because when you start making videos, the one thing that people really want to avoid is like motion blur, too much movement, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like the jittery sort of, steady cam look that a lot of people seem to like, that sort of action cam moving around kind of thing. All they're saying is that you don't have to have the same shot being the same.
Yeah.
So you can move it a little bit. You can pan it and move it around slightly. You can zoom in, zoom out. I mean, so just add a little bit of movement to make your shots look a bit better.
And I agree with the zoom in, zoom out, or, temporarily, like, repositioning the tripod. But actually taking the camera off the tripod for something other than, well, for creating a story, yeah, maybe. Since a lot of what I watch on YouTube are tutorials, it kind of, and how do I put it? The people who make the craft tutorials that I usually watch don't exactly have a steady hand. So, yeah.
Well, I think what they're saying for this is not necessarily do it like that, but
yeah,
just add different styles of shots in there.
And then,
there's things have come a long way.
Yeah.
With it being less expensive. Like, you can use a dolly shot. I think that's what they're saying, just to kind of vary it up a little bit. But
okay.
Yeah, granted, when it comes to how-to and craft videos and stuff like that, that camera needs to be locked down so you can see what's going on.
Yeah.
And I think adding too much movement in there or just trying to wing it doesn't really help. But if you're doing like a family video, pan across, do that sort of up and down shot. I mean, experiment a little bit. But when it comes to the real dramatic movement, the movie sort of the most dramatic moment in your movie, you should probably have it locked down so that you can really see what's going on. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So, and this one is this is the last one we'll talk about.
And this one, I, as a photographer, is one that I struggle with all the time, and that is put thought into locations and shooting times.
Yeah.
Usually when I have a free moment, it's not the best shooting time. It's usually late in the afternoon or too early in the morning. And you have to deal with, you know, the first thing in the article, lighting, as well as things like how many people are out and what type of setting is it. Is it a mountain environment? Is it an outdoor environment? And then, you know, foot traffic, things like locations. I was trying to get some shots of the Sandia Mountains, and I wanted to get a large, wide angle, like landscape type shot. But the position I was in, and it was the best shot of the mountains, these people kept walking in front of me to shoot their family portraits.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's a struggle, and it's easier said than done for this article.
Yeah. I mean, you know, I get it, what they're saying here. And these are super basic tips, but it does make sense. And I'm going to throw something a little bit different at it. If you're filming something, be aware of your surroundings. You know, a lot of people don't necessarily look, and they'll put a video up, and you look in the background, they've got, like, you know, trash in the background. I always think of that one person who posted a picture where they're in the bathroom doing a selfie, and in the toilet's full.
Oh.
And so I always look just to kind of see what's around me and sort of set my scene that way.
Yeah.
In the comments to this particular article, which I said, like, there's a link that you can kind of read up on it if you want, was a very sort of useful tip.
Yeah.
And people talk about different things and how, of course, some people are going to jump in here and give their opinions on what's the best. Like, one person said, invest in a halfway decent gimbal. You know, one person's like, what would you recommend for a gimbal? And this sort of thing can really go off the rails.
Which it did in a couple of these.
Oh, yeah. And it just keeps going on and on. This person, Candy Taco, which is better than Toe Cutter the Gray.
Yeah.
Which is a horrible name. Right? I bought an L bracket in a cheap LED light panel that makes every single shot look better.
Yeah.
And an L bracket you can buy off Amazon for less than $7, and an LED light panel can be pretty inexpensive. And they start off with lighting, lighting, lighting. Even if you have the best story and angle in the world, bad lighting will ruin a good video. And that is absolutely true. So the entire thing is, going back to number one, lighting is king. If there's one thing you can do to improve your videos, or if you're looking, and that even goes with photography in general, right?
Yep.
Lighting, you got to have lighting. So I really thought that was a really good sound advice that they offered up. An L bracket is a bracket that looks like an L shape that you can put your camera on, and it just gives you a point to hold on to the camera off the camera so that you can make your shots look more steady. And a light panel is just basically a brighter light than what you see, and that can definitely help. And they even put convenient little links in here.
Yeah.
So, and this person shoots with 24-70 f/2.8. So if you understand what that is, that's a great lens. If you don't understand what that is, then the light is king, and get more light in your video is a better solution. So in other words, if you don't know what I'm talking about, you know, just take this at face value. Because that's all I got to say about that. So I thought that was kind of interesting. So I'm like, yeah, it's pretty solid article without going too crazy into it, you know.
You know what I find interesting?
What?
The real King of England.
I know you would, so that's why I put this in here.
Yes. This is from Atlas Obscura, which, you know, they do a lot of weird news and things like that.
Yeah,
it's one of my favorite sites. Post lots of weird articles. This most recent one is that a token truther from Colorado says he's the real King of England.
What?
Yes. He even took an ad out in the Times of London to stake his claim. So, yeah. And, you know, the article starts off comparing this guy to the 1990s comedy King Ralph, but apparently this is stranger than truth is stranger than fiction. A Colorado man who believes that the works of J.R.R. Tolkien are more than fiction has formally laid his claim to the title of King of England.
Dang.
Yes. So, Alan V. Evans of Wheat Ridge, Colorado, he took out a very lengthy ad in the Times of London on Wednesday, claiming that due to his unbroken lineage trailing back to the fictional kingdom of Gondor, makes him the rightful heir and king of England.
Hmm.
In the ad, Evans traces his ancestry through real historical kings such as Cynedda Weldig, founder of Wales, before finally arriving at where he appears to think history intersects with the stories of Tolkien, with Wales being just a new name for what was once called Gondor. And this is a very, very long ad that he put out. But he intends to seize power, which is what I find very amusing. This guy is going to somehow make it from Colorado to England and expects, as soon as he gets off the airplane, to be crowned king.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't...
He's like, it's on like Donkey Kong.
Yeah, I don't think that's going to happen.
Hmm.
But the fact that he managed to intertwine the works of Tolkien with reality, I think this guy's just a little unhinged.
It is kind of weird.
Yeah.
But what if he's right?
There's no way.
You don't think so?
No.
Maybe it's all real.
No, it's not real. Pretty sure.
But there's a chance, though.
No. You know, it's also not real.
What?
This, actually, I didn't even read this one.
Okay, first off, how dare you? Oops. You should read every article I put up.
I kind of think these weird theories in this next article about who built the moon, these are not real.
But.
Yeah.
We don't know. Because, see, this person wrote a book, right? And this article is from November 25th, 2012.
Mm-hmm.
And it's an interview with Christopher Knight. And I guess he wrote the book. The Hiram Key is his first book. But then he did another book. And it's basically called Who Built the Moon. Right?
Yeah.
So his latest book, Who Built the Moon, I think he made it with Alan Butler or had an interview with Alan Butler. I can't remember exactly. But see, I got more interested into what the article was saying as far as how the interview went out.
Yeah.
And it has some pretty interesting stuff. Like, for example... this is what the guy says here. This is Christopher Knightson's is answers to questions, right? The moon sits very close to the Earth, yet it's widely regarded as the strangest object in the known universe.
Yeah.
And I was like, what? Okay, so I started kind of take a look at it, right?
Yeah.
And the book that the person wrote lists the strangeness of the moon, which includes the fact that it does not have a solid core, right? Hmm. Like every other planetary object. Which means that it's either hollow or has a low or very low density interior. So I'm like, okay, well, I didn't know that. That's pretty interesting. And its concentration of mass, right, are located at a series of points just under the surface, which has caused havoc with early lunar spacecraft. So the material of the moon is made from and came from the outer surface of the Earth and left a shallow hole filled with water that we now call the Pacific Ocean. So they're saying that the moon's composition is made up from material taken from the Earth from the Pacific Ocean. So okay. I've kind of heard that. And, where the huge asteroid sort of thing happened. And it says, this rock left the Earth to produce the moon very quickly after our planet had formed around 4 to 6 billion years ago. I thought that was kind of cool. I was like, okay, yeah, that's pretty cool. And the moon is not only extremely odd in its construction, but it also behaves in a way that is nothing less than miraculous. And I thought this was really neat. It's 400 times smaller than the sun, but 400 times closer to the Earth, so that both the sun and the moon appear to be precisely the exact same size in the sky. And what that does, that gives us the phenomenon that we have when we experience it every so often called the total eclipse. So I was like, I did not know that it was 400 times smaller than the sun. So I thought it was pretty neat. And so pretty much this is, we take it for granted, but this can be considered the biggest coincidence in the universe. So that was pretty crazy. I was like, okay. So, you know, it kind of goes on from there, but it also talks about how the moon mirrors the movement of the sun in the sky by rising and setting at the same point on the horizon as the sun does, but at the opposite solstices. For example, this means that the moon rises at midwinter at the same place the sun does at midsummer. And there's no logical reason as to why the moon mimics the sun in this way. that it's only meaningful to humans, that it's basically only meaningful to you, being a human listening to the show, if you're standing on the Earth. Because when you go outside of the Earth and you're in space, it doesn't make any sense either. It's just like, what's the point? So, I thought that was pretty neat. So, yeah, there you go. Who built the moon? Because what the book's trying to say is that with all the things that are going into it and some of the coincidences and how it's sort of shaped and formed and all that good stuff, is it even real? Is it a natural thing? I don't know. Or was it engineered, right?
Hmm.
So it's kind of crazy.
Yeah.
So anyway, I put that in there so you can kind of read that if you'd like. And there's a link to it. And it kind of goes almost, because I started going off down a rabbit hole. And I wanted to make sure that I didn't go down that rabbit hole where it kind of talks about different things.
Yeah.
You know, when you start getting into flat earth theory, reptilians and all this other crazy stuff. But I have heard through theories that the moon is a man-made or an engineered satellite, and then it's hollow, and then there's like bases on the moon, there's stuff inside the moon. I don't know, but I just kind of put that in there.
Okay.
And you can kind of read it and kind of follow along with it. And some of the side articles, the byline articles, are pretty interesting too. Like 12 interesting facts about the ancient Mayans. Area 51 facts, secrets, and things you did not know. And it just kind of went on, and that's when I sort of backed off of it because I was going to waste entirely too much time.
Yeah. The way this link is set up for me, it also shows me cool places we can go to here in New Mexico that we should probably talk about.
Well, we're not going to talk about them now, but basically all that was right there was Who Built the Moon? And it's an interview with Christopher Knight, based off the book he wrote. And it kind of goes, the book goes into great and agonizing detail to give you more sort of interesting facts, figures, and stuff like that. So, but yeah, that's why I put that in there. Like, ooh.
Okay.
But yeah, be careful, because if you go down that rabbit hole, you're up till 3 a.m. It's 4 o'clock in the morning. And, you know, there you go. Yeah, so it happens. So I think what we're going to do at this point is to take a little second and, play a commercial. And by commercial, I mean a little bit of music. So that we can take some drinks of water without being loud about it. That was delicious water.
Okay.
Okay. So, as I was doing my research, which is what I call goofing around on the computer, and by on the computer, I mean on the internet. And by on the internet, I mean Google, right? I found this. I thought it was really interesting. The ancient alloy attributed to Atlantis, right? It's called auriculum, or how do you
pronounce it? I kind of feel like you put this article in just so I could struggle to pronounce it.
a little bit, because I was hoping you would read it, so I would not have to pronounce it. Auriculum. Well, let's just do it like this.
Auriculum.
It's spelled O-R-I-C-H-A-L-C-U-M.
Auriculum.
Yeah. Can I get that in a sentence, please?
Auriculum is hard to pronounce.
Yes. So what this actually is, okay?
Yeah.
This is a rare alloy that supposedly was basically smelted on the fable island of Atlantis.
Ooh.
So off the coast of Sicily, right, a new expedition to a 2,600-year-old shipwreck has returned with 47 lumps of auriculum.
Yeah.
Or auriculum?
Yeah.
Auriculum? However you say that. Which is, like I said, a rare alloy that's supposed to be smelted on the fabled island of Atlantis. The shipwreck dates back to 600 BC. It was actually explored in 2015. And the underwater archaeologists found 39 ingots of the metal.
Back then.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the trip also yielded a jar that contained 2 Corinthian helmets.
No, and 2 Corinthian helmets.
Yeah, and 2 Corinthian leather.
Because if those helmets were inside that jar, we'd have a lot more questions about this article.
Maybe, so. Unless it's a big jar.
That's ridiculous.
It's an answer. Mm-mm. Sometimes the most obvious answer is the most obvious answer.
Okay.
So it's supposed to be a shiny alloy, much like brass. It's known from ancient texts like Plato, who described the metal as a rare metal mined in Atlantis, right?
Mm-hmm.
And Plato also described a temple to Poseidon that had an entire pillar made of this stuff.
Hmm. Yeah.
And it's also in a LucasArts fans game, right?
Yeah.
It's a feature of the computer game Indiana Jones and the Fate of Atlantis.
Okay.
Yeah. So they started describing the medal, right? Some Sicilian officials started describing the medal that they found there.
Yeah.
And they started calling it there by the same name. And they're like, hey, this is Araculum, or however you say it.
Yep.
Yeah. But see, here's the difference, though. The ingots were actually made out of zinc, charcoal, and copper. And that's what kind of sort of throws things off a little bit, because according to what everybody else was saying and some of the information that was found through all these ancient texts and manuscripts,
yeah,
it should be made out of gold, copper, and silver.
So it's not true, or just we interpreted what we wanted from the ancient descriptions.
Or maybe it really was made out of zinc, charcoal, and copper, but it was described as being like copper, gold, and silver. I don't know. But the metal found by the shipwreck matched the ancient descriptions, which is supposed to have a red tone to it. So I guess it's primarily what they're saying. It sounds like it, but it's...
I'm looking at the photo. The photo is really cool. It's just like this little square, and I'm like, ooh, I want one of those.
Yeah.
So, but it is interesting that they found them, so...
Yeah, I thought it was kind of neat. It's like, wow. Yeah. And if this square came from it, right?
Yeah.
That'd be kind of cool. But I don't think it did, because it basically says, not Araculum. Carlston Niehaus Public Domain. It's just a square.
Which makes me think, so Araculum in the history books was described as, you know, these mixed precious metals, but the only thing they found was this not-so-precious mineral combination.
Yeah. And one of the things I thought was kind of funny, because they talk about how it was mined, and it's like, you can't mine an alloy.
Yeah.
You know, alloy is an amalgam. It's a mixture of metals. So, and I got down to the very bottom of the article, and it says, correction, not as previously written, mined as alloys cannot be mined. And I'm like, oh, okay.
Well, even back then, I mean, people claimed that certain metals and mixtures were either mined naturally as a gift by the gods and stuff like that. So, I mean, that's how they explained a lot of metallurgy and things like that.
Yeah. So I thought it was kind of neat. That supposedly they found an ancient alloy attributed to Atlantis.
Yes.
So, I started to do some research to try to find some more of this stuff. Yeah. But again, it was going down a rabbit hole I didn't want to go down to, so I did not. But I thought it was worthy enough to kind of, talk about it. Because I had no idea that sort of thing existed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
And it basically, here's how it's pronounced, right?
Yeah.
Auricoculum.
Oh, that was close.
Yeah. And it says, a yellow metal prized in ancient times, probably a form of brass or a similar alloy.
Okay.
Like, alrighty then. So, and if you go to ancientorigins.net, talk some more about it, but I thought it was kind of neat.
Oh, wow. They even use it as in things like Guild Wars and stuff like that, which is a more modern game.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
You know, it's an ancient metal.
Okay.
So. It's just kind of one of those things where, and, you know, when you talk about or when you hear about Atlantis,
mm-hmm.
you know, Atlantis has always had a pretty decent reputation.
Okay.
You know, sounds kind of silly because this is a silly segue into our next story. But, I mean, think about it. Whenever I've heard of Atlantis, I've never heard of, like, weird stuff like, you know, they went out there and killed everybody and, you know, they were trying to take over and all stuff. It was always like a place of intelligence and
scientific discovery.
Yeah. You never really heard anything bad. So,
thing. They were so advanced and so far ahead of things, but they were so far away from everybody else.
Yeah.
Because everybody else was so warlike and terrible.
Yes.
So
what we're going to do is we're going to talk about the 10 companies with the best reputations. But after we do that, or before we do that, I should say, we're going to have a little bit of a commercial.
Okay.
Yeah. So here we go. So here's it goes. It kind of goes like this. Audible is the audio entertainment that entertains, educates, and inspires, and you can get a 30-day free trial, right?
Yep.
And you also get 2 free audiobooks that are yours forever. You get 1 credit a month after the trial, and it's good for any book regardless of price. An exclusive member savings. Get up to 30% off on additional audiobooks, and you can actually exchange these audiobooks. Did you know that? I did not know that.
If
you don't like it, you can exchange it. You can swap it for free anytime.
Cool.
And I thought this was pretty cool because we've used Audible in the past to get the audiobooks and when we go a little bit travel down the road sort of thing.
Yeah.
And so I have a link to it on our show notes and you can kind of click it. And if you sign up, you can get 2 free audiobooks and it's a 30-day membership. And I'll give you a little piece of advice. If you decide that you don't like it or you don't want to be subscribed to Audible, set yourself a little Google reminder, like a Google Calendar, to remember to unsubscribe.
Okay.
But yeah, it's a free 30-day trial, and just it's worth it for the two free audiobooks. So if you got some upcoming travel, why not give it a shot? Audiobooks are kind of weird, but I do like them, so
yeah.
Check it out. So we have 10 companies here with the best reputations.
Which is funny because, I mean, over the past few weeks, we have talked about companies with bad reputations.
Absolutely, and that's exactly why I put this in here, because we did talk about Vizio gathering all the information from its unsuspecting peoples.
And Samsung.
And those peoples are customers. Yeah. Samsung with the exploding batteries and crazy stuff like that. So to find an article that said this is the 10 companies with the best reputations, I thought was actually kind of a... I figured, why not? Take a look and
uplifting.
See.
Uplifting.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if it's uplifting. I'm like, well, yeah, the company did so great. But yeah, I get it. You know, it's kind of like. So we kind of went through and took a look. And, oh, and we forgot to talk about one of them, one of the companies. Wells Fargo has had its reputation severely damaged here in the past, what, year and a half or
yeah,
so?
Yeah, about a year. So.
Yeah. And then you always used to hear about stuff like Comcast and Comcast installers, like the one installer that went showed up to a house to do an installation and fell asleep.
Oh yeah,
on a person's couch. You know, so all these companies have had some pretty bad. You know, like Mylan, the company that you know they took the EpiPen and increased its price by like 500%.
Yep.
You know, yep. Stuff like that. So you know, here we go.
Yeah.
So who do you think? I don't want to give away number one. Who do you think number 10 is?
Because
there was 10 of these.
I don't know.
Now, this is from the Reputation Institute, of which I had no idea existed.
Yeah. I'm thinking, well, I'm trying not to look at the list, but I want to think about brands that I really like. I like General Mills.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's a good answer.
Really?
No.
Oh.
No, it is a good answer, but it's not the answer.
Aw.
See, I had no idea. Adidas is number 10 at 77.27.
Which is weird.
Out of 100.
Because...
See, here's how the scoring goes. The Reputation Institute, right, noted that this is the first time in the firm's 20-year history that a company has posted an excellent rating. Excellent rating would be 80 or higher.
Oh, wow.
So 70 to 79 is termed strong, and no company in top 100 score below 64. So the middle average is between 60 and 69. So pretty much 100 all the way down to 70 is where this score kind of comes into play.
Okay.
60 to 69, you didn't make the list. You're average. Let me give you an example.
Yeah.
Volkswagen dropped out of the top 100 last year.
Oh, yeah.
Because remember, they were lying about their EPA, or what was it?
Emissions.
Was it EPA? Well, their emissions and I think mileage a little bit, but anyway.
Diesel mileage.
Yeah. They finished in the 100th spot.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
So they've sort of fallen, but they've sort of worked their way up again. Yeah. Samsung. With the Galaxy Note 7 disaster, they dropped to 70th place, and their ranking is 70.98.
So they dropped down a whole 4 points in a year.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering, after this whole thing with their CEO or whatever, if they reevaluate how low they'll be then.
So, I don't know. But yeah. Samsung had a score of 74.98, and that would have placed them in the 2017 top 20.
Yeah.
Which would have pushed Apple out.
Yeah.
Because Apple went from 10th to 20th. At 74.94. So number 10 was Adidas. And Adidas, I had no idea.
Yeah.
So I was like, okay. Well, who do you think number 9 is?
I don't know.
Well, according to the list, Rolls Royce.
See, okay. So 9 and 10, yes, I am familiar with those brands. But I don't hear anything about them. In fact, the only time I hear anything about Rolls Royce is if... I guess the Grand Tour might mention them, and that's it.
Yeah.
You don't hear anything bad about them in the news. You also don't hear anything good, though.
That's true. But, you know, with Rolls-Royce, I always think of expensive and luxury.
And with Adidas, I think of shoes that don't fit my feet and kind of pricey hoodies.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
There you go. Well, Intel Core is number 8.
Again, another company I haven't heard much about in the past few years.
Oh, I have. If you're a nerd and you follow computer geek stuff, then you know you're waiting for the Intel processors, you know, which can be, because it's like it's in, Intel versus AMD.
Okay.
So Intel's been pretty good. And so 77.74 is what their score is. I'm like, well, that's pretty good.
That's respectable.
Yeah.
Oh, but they tied.
They did.
Yeah.
They tied with Sony.
Which is pretty impressive.
Yeah. And I haven't heard too many bad things about Sony. I just don't, for me personally, whenever Sony has an app that they put out there for use with a particular product, they never seem to update it.
And
that causes me a little bit of an issue. You know?
Sony has, in the past, had issues with customer privacy and customer information being leaked or hacked.
Yep. That's true.
Yet they're still maintaining this pretty decent score.
Yeah, that was with the gamers, right?
Yeah.
Not Xbox, but what is it? I'm not a gamer.
It was Microsoft Xbox and Sony PlayStation.
PlayStation,
users.
There we go.
Yeah, their accounts being
right now
hacked.
Our Lisa nerds are like, oh my God, he doesn't even know what a gaming station is.
Yes.
I'm 8-bit. Got news for you. We're back. Anyway.
Number six is, yet Bosch. Again, a company you don't hear too much about.
That's true. Yeah. They do make fine quality components, though.
That's true.
I've always had pretty decent success using Bosch, so yeah. I always look at them pretty favorably.
Now, number five surprises the heck out of me.
Doesn't surprise me.
Google or...
/ Alphabet.
Alphabet, yes.
Skynet.
They are ranking in at a 78.22, which makes them number five on this list. And I find that stunning, especially with so many tech bloggers out there blogging about Alphabet getting all of your information and invasion of privacy. The problem is, again, this goes back to limited user agreements and user agreements in general. You agreed to it. They're going to take your data. They're going to use it. But
it doesn't surprise me, though.
I mean,
because most people, I think, don't really pay attention.
And it's a great company. So it's all these like people like truthers, you know, like the guy in the last article and like conspiracy theorists who are writing a lot of negative stuff about the company.
Don't make them mad.
I'm kind of glad to see that it's not putting a big effect on the company as a whole.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Number four, I'm glad to see Canon came in at 78.28%. They beat out Google, Bosch, Sony, Intel, Rolls-Royce, and Adidas.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they do more than just cameras. They have cameras, printers, medical equipment, all sorts of other crazy stuff.
Office
and Canon's equipment. One of those brands where I've never really heard anything super crazy or negatively, you know, it's always been kind of looked at.
Yeah.
A little bit more upscale.
Ooh, you know. Fancy.
Yeah, fancy.
Yeah.
Number three is Walt Disney.
And that surprises me.
That doesn't surprise me.
Well, they have had a little bit of negative press in the past couple of years.
Yeah.
They also have had to cut jobs. So it is, and this whole campaign about making the princesses and all the Disney movies actually look like the ethnicities they're from. So it surprises me that they're so high at number three.
Yeah. Well, I think this is a company as a whole. And you got to remember Disney and Marvel together making movies and there's toys and all sorts of crazy stuff.
That
so.
Is true. So.
Yeah, I mean, Walt Disney has generally been received as being a pretty, I guess, on the up and up company. I don't know.
Yeah.
So. But number two kind of surprised me.
Not
number
me.
Two is Lego.
They are big.
At 79.46. I was like, what?
Yeah, they are big everywhere else. And if you ever look for Lego on social media, a lot of the top search results are very, very positive customer service and social media experiences.
Amazing for little plastic interlocking blocks.
Because, and we should do a whole episode on Lego about how the toy was basically created to spark a child's imagination, and that's why the product is so plain. But the plainness of the product that allows a child to build with their imagination as well as learning skills, like put together skills, and just a really great company, too. So
well, I like to suck them up in the vacuum cleaner.
I like to not
so
step on them.
Well, you know what? That was a rule. If I stepped on it, it went in the vacuum cleaner.
Ah,
like,
okay.
Bye-bye. Because so, you know, it's like it's terrible.
Oh, I wouldn't want to step on number one in this category.
Which is?
Rolex.
What? Rolex?
Yeah.
Yeah. Can't afford it.
I know. That's true.
But they do make some very nice stuff. And it kind of makes sense because... You know, I've always heard good things about Rolex.
That's
the watch you supposedly want to get.
Hmm.
And I'm not really a Rolex kind of guy. I would like to have a nice Omega, but that's just me.
Ah, okay.
Yeah. Kind of expensive, though. But yeah, I was surprised. So, I mean, out of these, the top 10 that we have listed here, we have Rolls-Royce. We have Rolex, which you think of luxury and stuff, and I would assume that they'd want to keep that luxury base happy.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have, like, toys, like Lego. And then you have Walt Disney. And then you have an excellent camera company called Canon, right? And then here, number five, right? Number five was the Google/Alphabet Incorporated. So I think part of it was, is what they did was they're like, we need to create a company that's not called Google so we can take some of the heat off of us. And that's what they did. I don't know. And then you have Bosch, Sony, Intel. So, yeah, I was really surprised to see that, and it didn't surprise me a whole lot when Volkswagen dropped because of their loss of reputation with the whole smog thing.
Mm-hmm.
And then Samsung with the exploding batteries and just general unhappiness there. And then Apple. Why did Apple go from 10th to 20th?
Probably because people were so underwhelmed with their technology.
And maybe the bloom is off the rose with Apple.
Yeah.
Their whole innovation is not innovative. It really isn't, because when you call yourself innovative by taking a feature away or by taking a feature that everyone else has had and has had for years and calling it innovative, I mean, come on.
Yeah.
And, you know, and I guess part of it is that since I'm actually using an Apple product now and, all of my – there's people out there that I'm sure that I know. Mm-hmm. They'll be like, oh, wow, you're using an iPhone now. Now your opinion will change. And it's not. It's just being cemented. It's like, wow. But, I mean, I like the hardware. And I'll be honest with you, the battery life in this phone is really good.
I know.
And if I had one complaint, the operating system is terrible.
That's true.
There's things that don't make sense. But anyway, that was a top 10 list from the Reputation Institute, which I didn't know existed. But the article is the 10 companies with the best reputations, and you can find those in the show notes as a link.
Mm-hmm.
And we do that for everything that we talk about. There are links in the show notes that you can kind of read at your leisure if you are so inclined.
Yes.
So there you go. That's about all I got to say about that.
Okay.
So do you have anything else that you would like to talk about?
Yes, I would.
What?
So typically we talk about weird stuff and whether or not it happens in New Mexico or Florida.
Yes.
How about orange alligators?
What do they taste like?
Where would they be?
Floridia.
Yes, because New Mexico isn't very conducive to alligators.
Yeah.
However,
you wouldn't want to get sushi.
No. Yeah. In fact, no, it's been a stations. Struggle.
Yeah.
I want some sushi, but I can't find any good stuff around here. Anyways, technically, you would be right. The most alligators do live in Florida. However, there have been several sightings over the past 2 weeks of alligators. And this all started with one of my friends back home in Virginia. She did some video of the Dismal Swamp on the Virginia side. And there are a lot more alligators out there. Usually it's a very rare sighting. But starting about 2 weeks ago, and then from there, in the Carolinas, a lot of the Carolina swamps, both north and south, orange alligators have been spotted.
Huh.
Yes. Very weird. Alligators are not normally orange. In fact, they're typically blackish-green or brownish-green. In the past, I want to say... Let's see. One of these articles is from like almost 2 weeks ago. Oh, no, it's from February 9th. Okay. Yeah. The first spotting was a small South Carolina town, Hanahan. They spotted a little alligator about 4.5 feet long, bright orange. And he got the little nickname Trumpigator.
Yeah, Trumpigator.
Yes.
Trumpigator. So, okay, so why is this thing orange?
That's the thing they can't figure it out. So...
It's a Doritos-like color.
Yes, and that's the thing that's shocking. If you go on Google...
Hey, check this out. Although one expert speculated, it's a non-natural color.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I've never... Okay.
It's so like, ooh, if you go so on Google and look for these orange alligators, they are very vivid orange. And it's not like slime or an infection or something like that, because like... I know, like, flamingos, if they get sick, they change their color, they turn white. But all these orange alligators, so far there's been at least 4 sightings of orange alligators. And they can't determine if it's an environmental factor, if it's an albino alligator that somehow swam around in a pollutant, or if a new algae is actually growing under the layers, the first or second layers of the scales.
So they're saying it could be
anything.
In nature.
Yeah. It could be anything, though. Could even be some new weird birth defect, nacho-flavored alligator. So
it is kind of crazy.
Yeah. And it's so creepy to, I mean, it's already stunning enough to have an alligator just come out of nowhere. But this is, if you were, you know, walking along the swamp and suddenly an orange alligator comes up, I'd be done. I'd just be done for the day.
Well, I think just if an alligator comes cruising up to me in general, we're probably going to have a little bit of an issue.
Well, one of them swims. But,
you know, an orange one.
Yeah.
Doesn't seem as scary.
To me, it does.
You'd probably be able to see him from a long ways off, I would guess.
That's another thing. Like, if you've ever been in alligator territory, the problem is during certain parts of the day, and depending on the water, you don't even see them.
Well, yeah.
You know? This thing is, it's bright orange.
Ain't no hiding that.
Yeah, and they're ranging anywhere from Calabash, North Carolina, to several reports in South Carolina. And then, I guess, northern Florida.
I wonder if it's just something that's sustaining the alligator.
That's what
scale.
I think. Because here's a photo of the...
Because they look kind of rusty to me.
Yeah. Here's a photo of a bigger one. And you can tell he's got patches that are still blackish. And then he's got two patches that are a pale. Like, he might be an albino alligator that got stained. Huh. So, maybe he grew up near a rusted boat wreck or something. I don't know.
So this is kind of weird because it does sort of talk about, you know, the possibility maybe somebody, you know, had to come in some kind of like iron oxide concentration and got, or maybe got paint all over there, you know.
Yeah.
But that wouldn't explain four.
Yeah.
There's like, well, there's up to four sightings of this thing.
It's anywhere from there being two to four of them. Apparently one of these alligators, he's big enough to travel far enough. So... The other one, we don't know. But there's been two sightings in North Carolina and then two sightings in South Carolina.
That's weird.
So, yeah. But it's definitely weird. I kind of want them to trap them and put them in a zoo.
Why?
Because it's unique. I don't. Plus, that means he can't hide himself against, you know, predators.
Well, he just has to go down.
Okay.
If he's in the water, he just has to go, just go low, bro.
Especially the littler one. The littler one is only 4.5 feet. This one...
That makes him fast.
The one that's in Calabash, he looks big. He looks like a big old, like, 7-foot alligator. And I'm like, ooh, God, no. So...
I don't know. I don't know what it is. To me, it looks like rust. I've seen rusty, you know, maybe they just got into some orange mud and let it dry. Who knows?
Okay.
It's kind of cool, though.
Yeah.
It's kind of scary. Kind of weird. Yeah. All I gotta say about that.
Okay. So, do we really have any binge-worthy BS this month?
A week,
I should say.
No. But the train to Busan, we talked about that last week, is actually really interesting.
Yep.
And Legion is still on. Grand Tour, you can always catch that. And, you know, that's pretty much... We haven't really did really a whole lot. Because the Grand Tour is on Amazon Prime. You can kind of check it out. And speaking of check it out, you can definitely check out our social media. You can check out The Ordinary Hiker on Instagram. You can also check out Leftovers 4, number 4 dinner, on Instagram. You can check out, CheapGeek on Instagram and CheapGeek Podcast. We've been posting some pictures there. If you take a look at it, you have some really interesting rock photos for people to peruse. Yeah.
I'm finding a lot more petrified wood, as a lot of little uncommon and rare things out in New Mexico.
Yeah.
And they're all pretty cool.
They are very cool if you're sort of a rock hounder type person. And, I've got a couple new videos that are up on YouTube you kind of take a look at. I found this really cool jack.
Okay.
It's like a bottle jack and a jack stand put together. And I was really surprised to see it. And what I'm even more surprised about is I thought it was like some thing that you would, that was new. You know, like that.
Yeah.
Evidently not. It was like four of my friends have one. They're like, yeah, I got one. I'm like, what? Because the thing about the jack stand is, if you buy a jack stand and a floor jack separately, you pay a bunch of money. This is all together. It has a wide base, and it, to me, it makes sense.
Yeah.
Because the jack stand is designed to hold your car up, so when you're not, you know. And the problem is, you jack a car up, then you have to figure out where to put the stand.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah.
This is all in one. So you jack it up, and then it basically sits on top of the jack stand. It was really inexpensive. And after we got stuck, you know, before in the desert, I decided that that ain't happening again. And anyway, I thought it was pretty interesting, so I made a video about it. So if you go to the CheapGeek 1 channel on the old YouTubes, you can kind of check it out and watch for yourself.
Cool.
Yeah. It is cool. Yeah. And being cool is cool. So, but yeah, other than that, there's really not a whole lot else going on with the old CheapGeek YouTube channel. We have been posting our videos and our podcast basically in multiple places. And I was surprised to find that SoundCloud and LinkedIn, believe it or not, seem to have pretty good reactions. So,
cool.
Yeah. If you happen to listen to us in some sort of weird means, I mean, aside from like iTunes or whatever, and you want to leave a comment, you can certainly do that. I'd be kind of interested to see where that's coming from. But
yeah,
realistically and honestly, we do appreciate people listening to the podcast. But we realistically are up to about 300 downloads.
Cool. That is
kind of cool. Yeah. That's pretty, because we always say like the 7 people that listen to us, the 5 people that listen to us. But yeah, I thought that was kind of something. Yeah. So I figured out where all those different places were that people are kind of listening to us. I thought that was kind of strange. But anyway, that's about really all we have. So if you are listening to the CheapGeek podcast and you have been listening, very much appreciated. You know, if you want to take the time and leave a comment, it's very much appreciated. If you don't want to leave a comment, that's fine too. But, you know, thanks for listening and giving us half a shot. So,
yeah.
Yeah.
We do appreciate it.
Yes, we do.
Yes.
So, anyway, that's about all the time we have for today. So, see you later. Take it easy. Bye-bye.
Bye.
I like peanut butter, I like peanut butter, peanut butter, I like peanut butter. I like peanut butter, I like peanut butter, peanut butter, I like peanut butter.